here at KingHSW.com. We're going to talk about the title of our show today is Row, Row, Row Your Boat. And you'll understand what that means in a minute. But before I do that, let me just remind you of our mindset moment for this week. Our quote was, "Don't let what you cannot do interfere with what you can do," by John Wooden, one of my favorite coaches. Nine times in a row, NCAA championship coach for the UCLA Bruins. Now, that's my lead into sports. A lot of interesting things going on, the least of which is, I say the least of which because I can't go. There's no games. And what I watch on TV is like 2016 Masters. I don't want to see that again. I saw it already. I want good stuff. Well, the good stuff that I'm going to report on with you today is about NFL draft. You got free agencies going on right now. You got guys like Todd Gurley who've been dumped by the LA Rams, and yet dumped at 25. That's just amazing to me. 25-year-old running back paid $60 million an extension on a contract. He's now going to get paid a $7.5 million terminate the contract bonus. I don't know what to call that. A payout? But he's going to get that. And yet, he is known to be a very popular running back. So that the prognosticators are saying, you got the Buccaneers, the Bills, the Dolphins, the Falcons, and the Colts that should be looking at him. And they're also saying that coaches are not necessarily the ones going to make the decision. It could be Tom Brady. Because they're saying Tom Brady needs somebody to wrap around himself. So I'd like a good running back to hand off the ball to, or a running back that should do a play action pass to, and he goes out into the flat and he's got some wheels, so Brady pitches it to him. That's the kind of thing that are happening in professional football during the draft and the free agency situation. We've got a new norm. Did he get picked up?
Yeah, Falcons.
Well, see, here, moment to moment, right here, our guest gives it, the Falcons picked up Gurley. And this report I gave you this morning was generated New York time at 9 o'clock this morning. So in those few hours, the Falcons picked him up. And they definitely need a back. That's for darn sure. And here's the thing. With Gurley, they say that he wasn't producing well enough, but in the 5 years he was with the Rams, the man did 5,404 yards of just running and 58 touchdowns. And he had over 2,000 yards of receptions. So that means that in his tenure with the Rams, he was over 1,000 yards a year anyway. And he said he didn't have enough carries.
Great.
Well, here's what's going to happen. They've added more games, so we're going to have more time to play, which means you can't run a running back 35 to 40 times anymore. It just doesn't make any sense. It's not a 12-game or 13-game season anymore. So they're going to have more running backs to round out a crew to be able to play that pass-run kind of combo, right? And play action being part of the scenario of the offensive coordinators. Well, it's craziness. I can't imagine what the draft is going to be like because it's going to be virtual.
Yeah.
There is no, I had my plane ticket. I had my hotel. I was ready to cover the draft. No draft. Obviously that's all canceled, but it's going to be virtual. Who knows what, I guess we're going to have maybe Zoom sessions where people are celebrating at their houses.
Yeah, right, yeah.
Yeah, just a little. So, the next thing I want to talk about is injury. We've got some injury reports to talk about, and not so much the report of an individual, but just the fact that injury is a big deal. And yet, Major League Baseball started back in February, pitchers and catchers meeting at the respective camps. And here we have the Red Sox once again. Chris Sale is going to have Tommy John surgery. Now, when he went in to get his physical, they looked at his elbow. Because he had elbow problems last year. Got cleared on all of that. Started throwing. Oops. Move up to the next joint and take a look at my shoulder. He's going to have Tommy John surgery. Which, and it's in such a disarray that he may not even, he like for sure won't be 2020, and he may not start the 2021 season on time. And here's where the Red Sox dilemma is. It's mostly financial. Their current pitching staff without Sale is not present. They've got guys that have left. They thought they were trading away and getting back good stuff. Well, that's pretty much a bust. And so the money they're spending on their current pitching staff is no longer an investment. It's a cost because they're injured. They're not going to produce. So those who are positive Red Sox fans are saying the $145 million you got to invest it, tongue-in-cheek, air-quoted it, is not going to necessarily be a big deal because you're restructuring your team.
Long-term investment.
Oh, my gosh, yes. Oh, my gosh, yes. So moving then back to football just for a moment. The question out there is, what is New England going to do? Who is their quarterback? Now, there's been names listed. Andy Dalton's been out there. Cam Newton's been thrown out there. Jameis Winston has been put out there. Hell, even Joe Flacco.
Yeah.
I go, okay, but a little danger. There's some pitfalls in there.
Yeah.
I think the real quarterback is Bill Belichick.
Yeah, I mean, he's orchestrator.
Well, I don't think it matters who's in the spot. Belichick will figure out something to do. That's just who he is. And then the last thing I'll say about football is kind of a tongue-in-cheek a circus act because it's about Jay Clowney. circus. Anyway, it's bad humor. $20 million is what he wants for an extended contract. $20 million a year. The answer should be no. No with that. Where he goes, who knows? Last couple things I'm going to say now about sports is March Madness. It's just not the same. It's gone. There's been rumors that they may bring something back. They're trying to honor seniors. What's going to happen? I say, look it. Practice, stay in shape, be active. I've posted on social media some things about sports psychology that I want you to take a look at for those people in your sports communities about. You got to stay positive. And being positive is being in your sport. So pick up your basketball. Dribble down the streets. We were talking off air just before the show started about we're going to have neighborhoods being policed that people are not walking together in crowds. And if you are, you could get fined. You could get fined. And if you resist, you could get arrested. So as I say this about my sports communities and the athletes in those communities, you've got your basketball and you're walking your dog, work on your handles. You've got an open field near you, go out and run. It's not going to be with your friends. Yeah. It's not going to be with your lifting partner. So make the best of it. Now, as I say that, I'm regretful. I'm going to end with a negative on the sports notes. We've got some more coronavirus recipients, one of which is Sean Payton at the New Orleans Saints, and then we have two Laker players three 76ers players are diagnosed with the coronavirus. I guess if I was an NBA fan and I went to any games for the Celtics, the Lakers, or the 76ers, I might want to get tested.
If you can get one.
Yeah. Well, good luck with that. So checking it out. So as you've heard a voice in the background, and for those who are looking at us, welcome. It's a Friday at 11 o'clock. Every Friday, 11 o'clock, you've got me, your host, Lowell Whiteman of 360 Performance. We're here with Evan Stratton, a vet. Thank you for your service.
Thank you. Thank
awesome
you.
To have you with us. I met Evan at a business gathering where there was a keynote speaker about resiliency, and I sat there and I go, Why didn't they ask me? I did kind of in my head, but there was a really good panel, and I met Evan, so I just kind of forgot about that part. So, because I just dug what he did, and he did it with three colleagues in a rowboat. Well, that's kind of a tongue-in-cheek when you say rowboat, because that boat's pretty stout.
It's a fancy rowboat, yeah. Five layers of carbon fiber, 28 feet long, two cabins. It's designed to get you across the ocean.
And I like the shark thing, the motif.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that was old school, you know.
A-10 Warthog, yeah.
Yeah, and the airplane, what was the P, whatever, the airplane that had that shark.
Yeah, the A-10.
Yeah, that's the A-10. Okay, that's the A-10.
A-10 Warthog, yeah.
Well, that's current jet. That's jet. Current. That's a tank buster.
Oh, you're talking about
that.
Yeah,
World War II.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, well, that design was way good.
Yeah, yeah.
I'll think about it. But Evan Stratton with me. Evan is at USMC retired, but he's an associate at Mercer here in Denver, the Denver office. I'll let you talk about Mercer in just a minute, but I want to make sure that people know in our mindset segment, we talk about getting the day started, building yourself in a self-aware way about what you want to leave behind in your activities for the day. And so that's what we're doing. We're going to talk about how do you get started rowing across the Atlantic. And another question I'm going to have for you is why?
The big question.
Yeah. So tell me, Evan, about the process of finding through college. When you talk, sitting around a coffee table, drinking some beverages, and you said, hey.
Actually, I didn't know any of them prior to the row. So we met to row on the row. Yeah, so Fight or Die is the team we rode with.
Yep.
We're a U.S. veteran nonprofit.
Yeah.
Last, in 2018, four veterans got together. They said, hey, we're going to go row the ocean. We want to raise awareness for mental health issues for veterans and, you know, bring the lights and the things that are going on in the veteran community. Let's go row across the ocean and the Taos will be the challenge. Why not, right?
So
they got signed up to do it, and then you're the second team to do it.
Give me the names of your colleagues.
So yep.
Punch out some shout-outs to them.
Absolutely. Yeah, so we have John Fannin, a fellow Marine. He's down in San Antonio, Texas. Works at Grunt Style, actually. So if you follow Grunt Style, the American Grit Facebook page, you can see him, and he's on there quite a bit.
Did he shave or not? Has he still got the beard?
He shaved after the row, all the things. I don't know. I don't know why.
I mean, grits, come on.
Yeah, they get kind of smelly. They stick in there, you know.
Fishy.
Trim up when you get back. That's gross. Then we got Luke Holton, who is up in Juneau, Alaska. He's a whaleboat captain, so if you're going to go see some whales, head up to Juneau and see Whale Tales, which is whale tours up there, which is pretty cool.
Been in Juneau, love Juneau.
Yeah, I haven't been up there. I've
been some snorkeling up there.
After he talks about it, yeah, it's really cool, Alaska.
Some of the best microbreweries on the planet here in Juneau. Oh, yeah.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Alaskan Beer Company, I think.
Yes, right? Exactly.
He talked about it a lot. Yeah, it must be good.
Yes, sir.
And then we have Carl Christensen, who is our boat skipper. He was our captain, and he's in Powell, Wyoming. He's a ditch digger. I mean, he works on...
literally a ditch digger.
Yeah, they do pivot systems on farms.
So oh, yeah.
Carl's just a good old country boy, working hard out there, running with the family right now.
There's some fence makers here in Colorado that want to have him on their team because they need a ditch digger to begin to do your fencing.
So. You know what's funny about it too? So he is a Naval Academy graduate and he's nuclear submarine qualified. So this is probably the smartest individual I've ever met in my entire life. And he's put together like pivot systems out in farms.
That's insane.
He used to be a brewer, used to be a distiller, used to make wine. I mean, he's just probably like one of the most interesting humans I've ever talked to.
Evan, I'm thinking ADD here.
Right? You can't keep a mind like that busy. You can't keep it down. He does everything.
He's rocking it.
Yeah,
all
he's
day
crazy.
Long.
Yeah, smartest guy I've ever
Stay
met.
Focused. Stay focused.
Come on, Carl.
All right, so you've got your three compatriots in there. You've never met them before. So how much time did you have before you first met them and then actually getting in the boat?
So we met virtually on May of 2019.
Okay.
So, you know, we're all four different places, very far away, different time zones even.
Yeah.
So we met via text, we're doing weekly Zoom meetings, doing some prep there. We met in person in August when we went down to Mobile, Alabama for 3 weeks to train on the boat. So we spent 3 weeks together training on the boat, getting hours, getting the boat retrofitted, getting gear, doing all that. Then back to our homes, and then we were back at our homes just virtual again until the race start.
Dude, that's crash and burn.
Yeah. Well, that's what we talk a lot about is, you know, when we look at how we were able to be successful and crossing the ocean, how we were able to put this together, it's the fact that we have that shared commonality of being veterans. And that shared history put us leaps and bounds ahead of other teams because other teams spend 18 months to 2 years preparing together. And they live oftentimes live in the same place and they're training together.
So you guys then went out onto the ocean, so you met each other again, together at the site, at the launch site, right?
Yep.
Your boat is there, but, boy, this is, now that you're getting this kind of stuff in there, that's like an intensive way to train and get results.
Yep.
So how long did it take you then with that kind of, to some they would say, well, you didn't train enough.
There's always more training you can do.
Yeah, exactly. So how long did it take you to get from the starting point to the end point?
Yep, so we launched from La Gomera in the Canary Islands, and it took us 50 days, 11 hours, 30 minutes to cross 3,000 miles all the way across the ocean to land in Antigua, Caribbean.
Nice.
So
was that record-breaking? What did that mean?
We set two world records. One is the fastest American team to row the ocean, and the fastest for our boat class. So there's different types of boats, and we were in a Spindrift class boat.
Now I noticed that this year, and last year, there were vet teams in the team listings as well. Were they in the same classes?
So the 2018 team, Fight or Die, we rode under the same team name, same boat.
Okay.
So we were the 2018 team, Fight or Die, was the first U.S. veteran team to ever row our ship. So they set that world record. We followed their footsteps, same organization, same like plan.
Okay.
New team, same boat, all that. And then this year there is another group of guys out in California. They are not rowing as part of our team. They're a separate team, but they are also rowing in a similar boat.
Gotcha. All right. So you've got, it sounds like a lot of different classes, very eclectic group of folks.
Yeah.
So I'm guessing there's going to be not an equivalency necessarily, but the opposite gender scenario, all women's team, I would imagine.
Yeah.
And then there's probably a mixture of teams for various reasons. Is it predominantly a fundraising effort or not?
No, it is. So the Brace is huge in the UK, and it's the Talisker Whiskey Atlantic Challenge.
Yeah.
Talisker Whiskey Atlantic Challenge. They're based out of the UK. It's the premier ocean rowing event in the world. So you cannot get bigger or badder in ocean rowing than the Talisker Whiskey. So it is predominantly used for fundraising. You know, there's a lot of reasons that teams get out here and join the race. You can row as a solo, in pairs, threes, fours, or fives. And there's a wide variety of the drivers to get out and get someone to row the ocean. But if you're going to do something big like that, use it for a good cause. And that's what most of the teams do, is a fundraising effort, and they choose all sorts of different charities.
So what was your cause?
So as Fighter Die, like I said, we're all U.S. veterans. We're an all U.S. veteran ocean rowing team. And our cause is showing veterans that they can get out there and continue to do really awesome things. That when you leave the military, that's not the end.
Yeah.
You have to row your personal ocean, address those issues like PTSD, TBI, depression, anxiety, reintegration. You got to face those challenges head on. And when you do, your life didn't end after the military. It's in front of you when you leave.
Yeah.
That's just a launching point. That's what we are really trying to do, is get veterans out there saying, hey, I can still get out there and do hard, hard things and be an example.
So did you have a numerical goal for your fundraising?
So it's expensive to throw an ocean. So we're looking at different things. It takes about $80,000 to throw an ocean. So we need to get the supplies to do that. Yeah. And then we're a grassroots organization where we're figuring out how we can best impact veterans. We know that the awareness is out there. People know that veterans are struggling. So how do we impact that? How do we make a change?
Yeah.
Part of that is, as an example, like you said, say, hey, get out there and row your ocean. We have strategic partners through Denver University's Stern Center of Military Psychology.
Oh, that's nice.
These are a group. This program is the only program in the country where psychology students can get their doctorate in military-specific psychology. So we're working with their students and their staff before, during, and after the race, and as research participants to help these students prepare to become military psychologists.
That announcement right there is a great setup for our next segment, which is about skills.
Yep.
Skills is my camouflage word for all five senses.
All right.
So I can imagine you're tapping all five of your senses while in the boat.
Oh, yeah.
And as a psychologist, you're interested in one's human responses with all of those things, because many times with a diminishment of capacity, some aspect of any one of your five senses gets a bit diminished, pushed back, or in some cases oversensitive. You know,
yep.
Get hypersensitive as well. So when you talk about that organization here in Colorado, is that a standalone or is that repeated in other places in the country?
So it's the only school program where if you're getting your doctorate in psychology, so these students are already going to DU to become psychologists with their doctorates, but it's the only program where you can get military psychology specific. So just like you go out and get a business major, well, you can do marketing, you can do finance, you can do things like that. So they're becoming psychologists in general, but their focus is working with military population.
Is that the only school that does it for the military population, or are there others?
It's where you can get a specific doctorate for military psychology.
Okay.
So they're becoming military-trained psychologists.
Gotcha. So let's remember, everybody out there, usvetrow.org is the website for Evan and his crew. I'm not going to downplay it. Talisker Whiskey, fine beverage, very fine beverage. But that's not my biggest emphasis. Now, if you want to follow the races, they've got a really kick-ass website. You can watch it virtually. You know, you get updates. If you follow a particular team, it's really cool stuff. But my purpose here is to make sure you know how to connect with Evan and literally his crew and look at what they did and what they continue to do as vets who honor other vets. So as I say that, let me just also mention to you that we're in a state of emergency all over the country, and more things are coming. Don't know exactly when or to what extent or degree it will influence your life, but be safe out there. All right, so continuing on, let's talk about the boat.
Yeah.
You got two ends of the boat,
yep.
Each having a cabin. In the middle is where you sit and you row.
Yep.
There's four guys but three stations.
Yes.
So what's your schedule? How do you know when you have to get in?
Yeah, so it's actually pretty simple. So you have two rowers on, two rowers resting.
Okay.
So you share a cabin with somebody. So me and John, both Marines, were sitting in the back cabin. So while I'm resting, he's rowing in the front, Carl and Luke. Luke's resting, Carl's rowing.
Gotcha.
And you do 2-hour shifts. So you row for 2 hours, you rest for 2 hours. You row for 2 hours, you rest for 2 hours, 24 hours a day.
You did say 50 days, right?
For 50 days, 11 hours.
Okay, I'm just thinking of personal hygiene here.
Yeah.
I'm thinking, okay, what the heck's going on with personal hygiene? The cabins are not that big.
No, very small.
Yeah, so I mean, and they kind of like come to a point. So
yeah.
Are you like head to head, toe to toe?
So, well, you're in the cabin by yourself,
oh, good.
Which is
oh,
nice.
Good. Oh,
well, unless, yeah. So you're in the cabin by yourself, which is pretty nice.
Yeah.
It would be hard-pressed to fit two full-size individuals plus the gear inside those cabins.
Yeah, yeah.
When you're in the cabin, the door's locked and shut because of the threat of waves or capsizing, you know, flooding the boat. You gotta keep those doors shut. And you're just sitting there trying to get whatever rest you can.
I'm just thinking smell here.
Oh,
I'm going, yeah.
Baby wipes. We
oh, my God.
Ran a water maker, so we would... You know, that's to rehydrate our freeze-dried food.
Yeah.
Our boat was completely packed out, so we have no supply boat following us. We have no support boat that's just following along in case. So we're 100% self-sustained. And in fact, if we take assistance from any other source, then we'd be disqualified. So you have 800 pounds of freeze-dried food. You have emergency life rafts. You got spare oars. You got spare parts for the boat. And you have a water maker that desalinates the water, so you have fresh drinking water to drink and says rehydrate. Yeah, every now and then you get a little Dr. Bonner soap, mix it up, wash out some of your clothes if you can, wipe yourself down a little bit, but you go nose blind pretty quick.
Yeah, I would. Oh gosh, yes.
Yeah.
Because I've not to the extent that you guys did, but I've been in similar situations both on land and water, and you better go nose blind quickly.
Yeah. it's salt, man.
Oh,
you get
yeah.
salt sores, so it's such a salty environment. One from the waves, but just in the air, the salt is gets in the air.
Well, like the joint areas, your armpits,
so
your elbows.
You get salt sores, so salt builds up under layers of your skin, and it'll just peel off, and like it's like a really nasty blister.
Yeah.
Like a blister that really hurts. So we get salt, I get in like my ears, and that would like really hurt.
I'm grimacing just thinking about it.
Yeah.
But I want to, look at guys and gals out there, I want to make sure you understand that it's one thing to be committed to a cause,
yeah.
And then it's another thing to be committed to a cause. Because
yeah.
rowing in the boat with all the things that you experience, and there's, we're going to talk about the wonderful things as well in a minute about the environment that you're a part of, but just setting the stage so you know, it's a commitment. So you better make sure that when you're taking shots at people who are supporting community projects, that you know precisely what their commitment is. Because there are some people that might best them in their effort and their actions in their commitment to the causes they support. So you talk about the rowing process, two on, two off, get some sleep. Sleep, what is sleep?
Try.
Yeah, exactly. But I have a question about the environment that you create when you're off the rowing schedule.
Yep.
What was the favorite music, that the genre or the artist that you listened to a lot?
I have so we had on the boat music, podcasts, books, all these things are really important,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
We got an Echo X ear speaker, which this speaker is like, I looked online and I was like, waterproof, dustproof speakers.
Mm-hmm.
This thing lasts the entire row.
Oh.
So this is not, I don't have an ad with them, but Eco X gear, if you need a durable speaker, go get them.
Yeah.
And
it's KUHSDenver.com. 360 performance.
Free advertising.
Yeah.
This is the last time.
Yeah.
So we had the speaker, and so we had I had Spotify Premium.
Okay.
John had Apple Music.
Okay.
Carl had Amazon Music. And Luke had Pandora. So we like covered the spread, right? Like we had all
yeah.
music. So you get it, like you download all the music on the phone or whatever beforehand, go on airplane mode, bring your phone. We're listening to music for the first 30 weeks. My Spotify turned off. One day, it's like, you gotta reconnect, verify your subscription. I'm like, what the heck? later that afternoon, Pandora goes down on Loop Stuff.
Oh,
The next day, Amazon goes down for the same thing. And then 2 days later, Apple Music does the same thing for John. So three weeks into the row, all of our music, like, shut off. We had, like, the 10 songs we actually had, like, bought on our phones. And then we had, like, some podcasts and a few audiobooks. So it was brutal.
Did you memorize anything?
We just sang our own songs on a Disney. No, the audiobooks are honestly, like, really, really awesome. And I had a bunch of podcasts downloaded. And it was really cool. You know, it'd be good because you'd listen to, like, a podcast for a shift or some of those things. But then, like, you know, you talk with your partner at night. Honestly, sometimes it's nice just to sit there in silence. And,
yeah.
You know, you're just there with your own thoughts. And at night, it's incredible.
I'm glad you said that because we're not in a rowboat, but we're in a situation in our communities that is kind of synonymous to being alone.
Yeah.
With limited resources.
Yeah, I feel great at home right now. I'm totally fine.
You've been trained.
Yeah.
You've been trained. But the point you made about, you know, being with your own thoughts, find quiet time, because typically with as busy as it is without a pandemic, we're busy.
Yeah.
You know, constantly stimulated with stuff. So I think there's a message there about, you know, be creative. I've got a lot of creative things happening these days. You know, the virtual dance, dance-a-thon with friends, or we have cooking lessons with folks, with the hope that you could cook. But with that being said, when you're with your own thoughts, what are some of the things in the environment that the ocean created that help kind of enhance that moment and really relish it and be wonderful?
This was, I feel like I went through like a biologic reset on this road. I grew up in the outdoors, camping, canoe trips, things like that, you know, so you can go a week without cell service and emails and no TV and unplugged.
But poking out your eyes, right?
I did for 6 weeks. I went where there's no emails, no work calls, no TV, no social media, no internet. And it was a truly incredible experience to wake up with the sun every day, watch the sunset go down every night.
Yeah,
to
be killer sunsets.
Yeah, absolutely incredible. The most incredible sunsets and sunrises I've ever seen in my life.
That's neat.
You can, you know, shooting stars at night that were like flashes of green, more stars than you've ever seen. Nights where there was so much cloud cover and the moon was gone, it was like pitch black. You couldn't even tell the difference between the water and the sky.
Oh,
I mean, we went through this incredible moment of just quiet without all this input. When I got back from the row, and within the first 24 hours of being on land, I already started feeling stressed just because of the amount of input.
Oh,
and being surrounded by people and things, you don't realize the amount of little stressors and little things and decisions you make that are just on autopilot. You make, by the time you get to work, you probably made 50 decisions for the day. Now, not big important ones, but things that you're putting on autopilot in your life. And it's been a really incredible experience to go from that and come back and see a stark contrast.
Yeah.
So if you are at home right now, really use this time to completely unplug. You don't necessarily need to get on Zoom and stay connected with people. Use it as a time in a selfish way to really sit down and like take time to be with you.
Well, and or go a step outside of that a little bit, read a book to your kids, whereas before you may not be reading enough books to them, or being creative about take them outside to a local field of grass and find a bug.
Exactly, this is an opportunity to be unplugged. You know, if you look at it. And it's having done that for 6 weeks was truly incredible.
So Evan, with your transition from military life to citizen, relate that transitional experience to the experience from the boat back to land.
Yeah.
Were there similarities?
There are similarities and differences. So, you know, when we talk about PTSD, traumatic brain injuries, and some of the suicide amongst the veteran community, those are serious, serious issues, and they are much more prevalent in the veteran community than the civilian community. 100% of veterans, however, though, go through reintegration stress of some kind. You lose your security, you lose a community, you lose an identity. Just in the same way when you go to boot camp, you have to become a Marine. They take you away from being a civilian to make you a Marine. You don't get that with me. You have to figure it out. So every veteran goes through this process where they look at themselves in the mirror and say, well, who am I going to be now?
Yeah.
What am I going
to
be now?
Well, and isn't there a set of expectations that they start to experience from those around them when they get back? And it's the loving, caring kind of experiences, but it's also within that exchange of moms, dads, girlfriends, wives, like, you know, whatever, the family, you get... You expect that? Really? That's what you want me to do?
Yeah.
So there's this
Meet the bar. The bar's high.
Yeah, it gets heightened quite quickly.
Right, but you lose a lot of your ability and security and support to be able to meet that bar. It's a very intrinsic answer of what am I going to be? So when I left the military, I had to answer that question. I had to figure that out.
Yeah.
And, you know, I got scrappy smart with it. And I went through a lot of difficult things, and I utilized a lot of resources to help get me to a good place. So I went and sought counseling for PTSD. I went and sought help for my traumatic brain injury.
Was that on your own, or was the military supporting you with that and available with resources?
So it's through the VA and through other resources there. So the veteran, I found great doctors at the VA. I found not so great doctors at the VA. So during different times, I was using different resources, whether it's veteran nonprofits or just personal resources. And I had to lean a lot on my support system, so my family and people to help keep me going when I wasn't doing so well. So answering that question, though, and figuring that out is what got me on the road. So I had to row my own personal ocean. And that's what we're trying to get veterans to
that's
do.
A good point.
Is that not every veteran can go row an ocean, or should row an ocean, but every veteran needs to get out and row their personal ocean. And it's hard to leave a safe harbor.
So I'm going to add, because we're in the segment we're in on skills, with what Evan just said, be aware of your five senses. Everybody knows what those are. They're simple. They're easy to touch and figure out. So use that as a way to anchor yourself in those transitional times. What do I see? How do I see? What do I hear? Why do I hear it? What is it I'm hearing? What's the smell? What's the taste? You know, and that way it's a good way you can control those, that onslaught of stuff
totally
coming to you, and simplifying it, whether it's for a military person coming back to being a civilian, or you're rowing, you're back on land, or you're a football player or basketball player and you're transitioning from contract to contract, or you're starting a season and it gets quickly shut off on you. Rely on the five senses to anchor yourself back into something that you can control. Because too often, when you're challenged with those kinds of emotional and physical pressures, it's, where's my control points? What
absolutely.
Do I have that I have control of?
Yeah.
So I want to wrap that, what Evan just said, with that kind of stuff. We're into our next segment, which is mental conditioning. And mental conditioning is all about environment.
Yeah.
So I want to come back to the boat and the environment.
Yeah.
So you got the waves, right?
Oh, yeah.
Now, I've been on big lakes in the United States, like Lake of the Woods in Canada. It's a big, big lake. Lake Michigan, big, big lake. And it could get some pretty nasty waves. But I'm sure you saw some waves.
45-foot waves.
Yeah, how did you handle that?
Stuff.
Was that a surprise to you?
Yeah. So we trained in Mobile Bay, Alabama. We had a great
support. Oh, big waves there.
Yeah. We got some choppy days, you know, going in on the Dog River. But so, you know, not quite open water.
Yeah.
About 3 days, so you get to La Gomera 12 days before the start of the race. Mm-hmm. You got work on the boat, there's a lot of things to do. 3 days before the race starts, you start getting weather reports. So every morning, all the teams get together. We have a meteorologist that's provided by the team that you have, and they say, hey, these are the weather conditions. And once again, we go back, this is a UK team, right?
Yeah.
So we have the safety officer comes out, starts giving us a brief. He says, things are going to get a bit punchy.
What the hell does that
mean? What does punchy mean, right?
Yeah.
It means 30 to 35 knot tailwinds, rough. Humble, fast start. So
new definition, the white caps, isn't it?
Exactly. It really was. So you want bad weather on the row. So flat water on the Mobile Bay, we can row that boat about, you know, 2.5 to 3 knots. Which sustained over 50 days, that drops down to like 1.5 to 2 knots. So you want tailwinds and you want waves because you can get going faster. You start riding waves, so now you can go up to 10 knots. You know, so you want some bad weather, but there's really bad weather. It was cool to have this really rough, tough start because it was trial by fire. There was no easing into it. Leading up to the row, I used to lay awake at night every night, and, like, trying to put myself in what would scare me on the ocean. So I'd envision myself laying in bed in the middle of the night on a boat on like waves you can't see getting hit, you know, because it scared me. But
yeah.
I was like, I want to get used to that. And that's exactly what we got.
How do you sleep in it?
Oh, you can't.
I mean, it's like being on a slippery slide.
You're getting knocked around, so. Boat is 5 layers of carbon fiber, so it's a few inches thick, very, very strong, but very thin. When you're in the back of the cabin resting, and that's what's tough, you don't truly get rest because the waves hit the boat and it sounds like a Mack truck is rearing inside the boat. You wake up when the boat gets knocked, so you're flying through the air right before you hit the side of the wall, Like, you're just getting beat down left and right. And then when you're on shift, you're getting waves knocking you out of the sea. Your boat's getting tossed around. The waves are ripping the oars. It's tough.
I'm sure at some point that was fun for a moment. And then the fun was lost very quickly. So when you were doing the waves and you got the winds and stuff, did you learn new techniques on how to use the wave to like, because you're not good, you don't want to roll into the wave as much as you want to let the wave launch you and then roll out of the wave.
Yeah, you want to try and keep the waves on your aft, so you want to have them push you. It doesn't always work perfectly because you still have to go the direction you need to go.
Yeah, the current.
So you know the waves don't just come in these nice predictable sets. Sometimes they come this way, and then they shift to go that way, and then they shift opposite.
How could that be, Evan?
So you really learn to like kind of like look for it and time it. What you do when you get these, you see these waves start coming, and you're talking with your row partner, you're like, let's go, row, 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 because you get up to the top of the wave, and then you like surf it down.
Yeah, exactly.
And you get these, like, you start like noticeably going faster, and it, you know, it turns into kind of like a game where you're trying to surf these waves.
I'd be into that.
Yeah.
I'd get all excited about that.
Yeah, it's fun.
Like surfing the wave, that'd be awesome.
But it sucks that, you know, after like, you go 3 days of getting these waves, and it's like, I just wish this would stop. I just want a break. We need some, like, a calm day to, like, do some stuff on the boat. And then you get the calm day, like, 2 days in the night. You're like, I just want some waves so we can go fast again. So it is this constant, just, like, back and forth battle. Like you said, you get over it quickly. We're out here for 50 days. So you go back up. Like, one shift, you're, like, all about it. And then the next shift, you're just struggling.
So what about the environment was the most intriguing to you? Was there a day or a series of moments that just, oh my god, that's just going to stick in my memory forever?
You know, some of the sunrise mornings, which is truly incredible. I've never seen a sunrise like that, where you're just on the water, and you and your row partner will just stop rowing, because you have 180 degrees of sunset, right, or sunrise, where you look as far left as you can, as far right as you can, and it's just these absolutely incredible.
Just capture the mind, doesn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I've never seen something like that. You can't see it on land. We get great, in Colorado, we get wonderful sunsets and sunrises here, but it's like the way there's a tree way. It was like being in the front row seat to the sunrise every single morning.
That's very neat stuff. So when you see things like that, what else about the environment enhanced that moment? Was there, I mean, the water's obviously all around you, obviously, but did you have moments when you had that great sunrise or life?
Yeah.
Was there birds or fish or whatever?
We saw whales, we saw dolphins. There was fish. You get this like biodiversity of plankton that night. So you'd be rowing and you'd like the water would just light up greens and blues. It was really cool. Get these jellyfish come by, it'd be like filled up with the plankton. It's like giant glowing green jellyfish would just float by.
You have to have a hell of a picture album.
Yeah, we're working on the video. I promise everyone that our fans and followers will send out videos and pictures.
Oh, that you had to be just overwhelmed with material.
Yeah, we all brought GoPros and
to get through all that, to put it together.
It's such a wild experience because it was like the most beautifully simple living. I mean, you're out in this very austere environment where there's a lot of risk. And there's a lot of, you have to be in the moment and in the game, but it's just so simple. Like I said, you're like, the demands of work and life and stress aren't there. It's just like you felt like you were just connected to the environment.
Well, I don't know if I told you this, but I'm on the board of the Denver Film Society. So I know a lot of documentarians and feature film makers. So that would be an outstanding video to showcase and help with the fundraising aspect to get that out, get it promoted to movie goals.
That's what you do.
And then I don't know if you know, we've got the Wyoming Colorado State Football Challenge, the Border Challenge.
Right.
And they do it, they get their respective ROTC units to run from CSU, from Wyoming, to the border.
Wow.
In their gear.
I know that.
Yeah, in
That's
their
pads.
So you could use moments like that to showcase that.
Here we are. Yeah, we're
all means of helping the vets.
Yeah, we're a grassroots organization. It's Fight or Die. It's OAR. We're on Facebook and Instagram. And please.
Yeah, we'll connect.
We'll connect, yeah.
Yeah, we'll work it out.
I love it.
We'll work it out. All right, so we're into we're getting close to our last segment, but before I end the mental conditioning, which is about environment, give me a kind of an inventory. What was the favorite, how do you say this, dry food? What was your favorite food?
The dry food, there's no favorite.
Exactly.
Dry food. Yeah. We brought peanut butter and fruit snacks and like trail mix, and that was like
gone.
Yeah, that was the hot commodity. We were running on fumes towards the end. I actually did better than some of the other guys. They were all getting pretty picky about the food, and I was just shoveling it in my mouth.
Yeah, so, what?
You gotta eat.
Well, you're on the, what are you gonna do?
Yeah.
You can't say, hold on, let me go down to Pizza Hut.
Oh my god. Yeah. I've never had such lengthy, intimate conversations about food in my life, and I'm not. I mean, you just, I go 2 hours on shift talking with Carl about our food plan when we got back to land.
All right, so let's extend it to that. So you have these plans, you talk about in the boat. What of them became reality? And what was the reality on the food side of things when you get
there? When we got back, I mean, when we got back to the dock, you know, there's 400 people there, our friends and family from Dunville's last time. We set foot off the boat, we had Gatorade, beer, cocktails and hamburgers and fries and chips and candy.
And your body's not prepared to take any of that.
No, it didn't matter.
Stomach's about like that.
It doesn't matter. Just give it a minute and come back again.
It's like going to a truck shop, choke and puke.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it was just incredible. We stayed at this huge house that was donated to us in Antigua for 4 days.
That's nice.
And everyone's just cooking every day. A lot of the dreams came true.
So, peanut butter, the snacks, the things that were really good early, but then once that was gone, what was the staple that you looked forward to? Even though it wasn't that satisfying, but it was something that, oh god, I'm gonna eat that because it's the best of the bunch.
So, you know, it's so crazy is that as sick as the freeze dried food we were, it's all relative. A week before we hit land, our power on the boat completely lost power. So, we lost our ability to make water in the water maker.
No.
So, we were down to our emergency rations and emergency water bottles. So, now we went from having a variety of meals, which was the freeze dried food with different types of meat. Only being able to eat bagged lentils for a week.
That just sounds bad,
right?
Just saying.
So you complain about the freeze-dried food, but then it can get worse. And that's like the perspective changes. It's hard to answer that question.
It's like, that's like sucking on a rock in survival training. I'm just like, that's nasty.
It was not the greatest environment to be in. And so that's why it's all relative, because at one point on the road, we're sitting here talking about how bad the freeze-dried food are. And then for the last week, we're sitting there wishing we could eat freeze-dried food again.
Yeah, exactly. I'll eat it freeze-dried. I'll just eat it chomped.
So
it's a matter of jerky.
Yeah, it's a matter of perspective. It's really just trying to, like, you know, be positive no matter where you're at.
And I think that comment right there of perspective and being positive, I talk about on the show, you know, people have, in my profession and as a coach and an athlete over the years, be positive, let's get motivated. I go, that's great, but what about the negative that we didn't talk about?
Totally.
Let's get rid of the negative. Because it's hard to be positive and sustain it if the negative is still floating around you.
Yeah.
But usually that's the elephant in the room. People don't want to deal with the negative first because it's difficult.
Yeah.
It's tough to do.
Yeah.
But you know, I'm going to guess from your experience in the military, especially as a Marine, they forced you to deal with the negative first.
Yeah.
Get after the tough stuff.
Yeah.
And get it out of the way so that we can sail. And your example of the waves, like fight it going up knowing that, oh, cool. We're skating going down. So I want to talk a little bit about that as we move into our last segment, which is about performance results. And it's my way of camouflaging, again, process. Because to get to results, you got to deliver a process.
Right.
You can plan and plan and plan and structure, but if you can't deliver all that stuff with a process, you're going to have a hard time hitting the numbers, getting the results that you want. So when you're in this last week, power goes out, what's the process?
Yeah.
What? How do you stick on it and stay with it?
So, you know, the process doesn't change because you still have the row. And what you learn on this row is I've never been in a situation like this was the most difficult thing I've ever done in my life, where there's days where I did not want to do it. There was many days and many times I was like, I cannot do this.
Yeah.
And we did it. And we kept going. And all you did was just one stroke at a time. And you kept pushing. And that's what the highlight to me to answer your question is that there's a difference between difficult and hard. Before the row, I probably would have said this is going to be the hardest thing. Hardest being you can fail, right? So you need to know the difference between what's hard and difficult. Hard are things where there's real consequences of failure. And there could be, you know, catastrophic fallouts, those things. Difficult are those things that we don't want to do, but if you just push for a little bit longer, it'd be done. And you'd look back and say, I'm glad I did that. Or even if you just get started, at least you're
good. Yeah.
And that's what I learned is that, you know, that is very, very difficult. But you can push through those difficult things. There are very few things in our lives that are hard. Where if we don't do it, it's going to be catastrophic. There's going to be very bad consequences.
Yeah.
Most everything we face is just difficult. And we have to tell ourselves to keep pushing. And so when the power goes out, what do? You keep rowing. Because if you ain't rowing, you ain't going.
Well, and I like the fact that both in real terms and metaphorically, your statement is apropos, because one, you experienced it. You had to row.
Yep.
And then metaphorically, if you're facing hard times, but then difficult times pop up, you still got to row.
Yeah.
Get after it.
You have to keep pushing forward. There's nothing in this life. You have to keep going forward, no matter what. You just have to. You can't go and hide and pull up anymore.
Yeah.
You just can't.
So I'm adding to what Evan is sharing with us from his both personal experience and what he's done in his life as a civilian, a military person, as well as a person supporting those that are facing the hard versus difficult question. And in our segment here about performance results, it's a process. It's getting after it. I'm adding this to it. Identify the negative. Be aware of where the negatives are and practice knowing where they are, because then you can anticipate. You know that when you get into a situation, the next time he gets in a boat, he knows, you know what, we could lose power. You better be prepared for that, because he went through the experience. When you go through your experiences, like we're experiencing now in our neighborhoods with this pandemic and the emergency situations that our politicians are asking us to face, and that they're legislating to, there's a group of legislature, but we'll deal with it. It's a negative. I'll deal with the negative and handle it. It's working with those people, as Evan said. He had family, friends, met him at the docks when they got there, a great house donated. All of those things created a situation of then, after identifying the negative, the power went out a week ago, we came in eating the lentils. That's just sad. It's very sad. But we did it. And we dealt with it and got
set to
it. And set to a world record. And you know what? You didn't know you were going to set a world record either, did you?
No, we didn't.
You just processed through it. You did what you needed to do in handling the situations as they came to you. So with that being said, what did you do? Let's go back to the beginning.
Yeah.
What did you anticipate as a crew and start creating a process? What are some of the key things now that you look back on it? That, oh, I'm glad you did that. When we started this plan.
Man, that's a good question. There's a lot of prep that goes into this. Like I said, most teams spend 18 months to 2 years preparing. We spent 7 months. We relied very heavily on experience for us to be able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
So we had a coach who she actually built our boat, and she rode it in 2015.
Power was a question, though.
Yeah.
We got back to her, right?
Yeah. We're figuring that one out. So we couldn't really anticipate that one. That was kind of like this. So we relied really heavily on the resources of the people that we know that have the experience. So if you don't know something, find someone that does know how to do it, and rely very heavily on that. The race does dictate a lot of training requirements, so you have to have a certain amount of hours on the boat. So when we were in Mobile, Alabama for 3 weeks, we were out rowing that boat every day, and it was a constant shift and change. So like, hey, let's move this here, this doesn't work there.
Gotcha.
Let's get the seating arrangement set, let's move the oar locks so we can get a better rowing position. This is where we should center up here.
And that was an adjustment for your body types, right? I mean, because you guys, we all pretty much the same height, right?
No, so I was the tallest one, but at 6'3". John is like 6'1". Okay. And then Carl and Luke are like 5'10", 5'11". Sorry if I'm over or under size.
And then there's weight differences.
There's weight differences. So we thought about stuff like that. John and I are tall. Well, we should share the same row station, so we're not having to make adjustments every 2 hours.
Yeah.
So we decided to do that. A lot of things like that. We put the life raft, which is very heavy and bulky, in one spot, and we go with it and realize that's not the spot for it. Let's move that.
Yeah.
So a lot of it is just familiarity with what you're doing. None of us have a rowing background. None of us have ever rowed in any sort of way prior to setting
that
up.
You want to have that background for that kind of effort. I mean,
a lot of rowers get out there and some of that stuff.
Okay.
But yeah, so it's kind of getting familiar. You know, if you don't know how to do something, get familiar with it. That's really what a lot of the prep was.
In that prep, did you do any what-ifing?
Constant.
Okay.
Constant.
What were some of the major what-ifs that really came to bear fruit for you in a positive way during the actual transatlantic journey?
So we had built in a lot of SOPs, standard operating procedures. That's kind of a military thing where you have like contingency. So if this happens, here are the steps. We put out serious ones, right? So like, what if there's a medical casualty? What if there's a fire on the boat? What if those sort of things?
Yep.
But then a lot of it was like, all right, so what if our foot plate breaks? The foot plate is critical to us being able to steer. Well, we have spares. Okay, where are we going to keep those spares? Well, if it breaks, we're going to need to be able to get those quickly, so we need the tools to be able to fix it and the supplies to fix it. And so we would do things like that to make sure that was available on hand. Because there's a lot of stuff, like, you don't want to pack that in a hatch under the lifeboat. Otherwise, you can't get to it.
Makes sense to me.
The first night we were out when we were in 30 knot tailwinds, I put it.
Oh.
We had to repair it at night while we're getting hammered by these waves. It was, you know, good thing that we thought ahead and said, what if we need this? This is where we
was it that cloudy night when it was really, really dark?
It was very dark.
Oh, there's stars.
Oh, no, it is super dark. We had just started the row. Like, we'd barely been out for 24 hours.
Yeah.
And we're just getting pounded. So.
You know, the most interesting things happened at the worst times.
Yeah. You can get through them.
Yeah. Well, yes, you could. You're right here with us. So, as you look back at the event and you're reflecting with other people, like other people like, take this people, Michelle Obama, and not just hello, how are you, but you know this hug kind of thing. It was it's a good picture.
Yeah,
it's a great picture. So you talk to these people. You get all these people asking about your experience and that kind of stuff. What's the constant thing you say to them from a personal point of view? That was a benefit for you. What did you get out of it?
Yeah, I think I mentioned some of that was a true understanding of what is difficult and what's hard.
Yeah.
So I had a whole new perspective of what I'm capable of doing, and that was really big. You know, the other really big thing I learned though was reflecting like how have I gotten some of these opportunities, and how have I gotten through some of these things. You know, I'd like to say I'm not an exceptional person. I'm not exceptionally skilled. I don't have a higher than anyone else, you know, capability.
Yeah.
But I've always been very exceptional about saying yes to opportunity. So through some of my experiences, I've had a unique level of opportunity to walk into my life,
mm-hmm.
and I've always said yes to those things. And that's how I ended up on this road, and that's how I ended up, you know, and some of these other things.
Yeah.
And I was always by saying yes, and it's been amazing to me that by saying yes to opportunity, the way that the resources and support surround you as you step out on your journey. You know, I could have easily said, I have a 9-month-old son, I can't go on this row, I would have to take time off work, I shouldn't do it, all these things, but saying yes to opportunity, things will work out. So say yes and go out your front door and seize the opportunity.
Oh, that's a great message, Evan. That's a great, great message.
That's a constant for my life.
So with that constant, and it's, you know, it sets some standards for yourself, things you expect every day when you get up, but taking a look back to how we begin our show with the mindset, waking up with, it's all about me, I can do, self-awareness. But now with this experience, what more is there? Because it's one thing to find the opportunity, but then are you creating opportunity? Is it, has it raised your level of consciousness and awareness to a level that says, I'm looking for this and this and this and this?
You know, absolutely. You learn by saying yes to opportunity, you learn more about yourself. By taking risks, you learn about difficult things, and the difficult things you learn to push through failure. So when you say yes to an opportunity, that's not a silver platter. Things are never perfect. The environment is never great. There was not a single time on that row when we had the wind, the waves, everything pushing us in the right direction. It was a constant battle through and through. And that's true of our lives, that you can't wait for the perfect opportunity to come together, because it just won't. But you have to say yes to the opportunity, and then you become more resilient, and you learn more skills, and you learn how to push through failure, and you get more tools for yourself to be able to seize a bigger opportunity and a bigger one.
Yeah.
So when I say yes opportunity, it's compounding interest. Every time you say yes, you learn new things, and you get the next opportunity is that much better. When I first left the military, I'm not who that person is anymore. And I thought that was a success. When I worked through those hard things, I thought, like, I did it. I made it through some of this hard, difficult stuff.
Yeah.
And now I just rode in the ocean. And I look back on my life, and it's just this perspective changes each time on how, like, I become more aware of myself. And every time I say yes to an opportunity, I learn something more about myself each and every single time.
Those are things I want to make sure people understand in today's show, that we're here to talk about Evan and the team that he participated on at the usvetrow.org, check that out and look at what he's done. But also I want to add this to what Evan just said. There are words in my world that mean things to people, and then I ask them to think about them in different ways. And here's a couple of words. Self-directed versus self-accepted. Now, both seem very positive, But to Evan's point about the challenges, and things are hard versus difficult, being self-accepting means somebody brought it to you. Being self-directed means you bring it to something or someone else, that you're behind it. It's your drive and your desire that's directing that action. I'm not saying that either one of them is good or bad. I'm saying you get to make a choice, and that you consciously are aware of being self-directed and self-accepted. Because there are moments when you're too often we are self-accepted from the wrong people and things. And at the same time, when we are self-directed, based on what we're motivated by, we might not be the most positive in our self-directed behavior. So it's not a perfect world, and there are goods and bads. But I want to make the distinction for you out there that words mean something, and they mean something in the way you act towards others, for yourself. Now, I'm really grateful that Evan Stratton is here with me today. I'm even more pleased that I believe I can build another opportunity for the two of us and continue to build the relationship and move forward. And this is going to be the last time for a while that we have a guest in the studio because of the current state of affairs. So we're going to do a lot of Zoom stuff because we can do that here at KUHSDenver.com. We're in the last few minutes of the show, and I'm going to ask Evan to share with us what he wants to make sure you take away from his time with us today and how he would like to see any of you support him and what he does with those vets that need our support and helping them through their decision-making about what is difficult and what is hard.
Awesome, thank you. Thanks a lot for having me. You're welcome. Really great. If you are interested in our story and what Fight or Die is doing, please follow our journey at Fight or Die, O-A-R, Fight or Die, on Facebook or Instagram, or check us out at usvetrow.org. You're going to learn a whole lot about ocean rowing and some of the really cool things around there. It's a lot of fun to follow along the race and the preparation and everything that we're doing there. And then just look for those opportunities in your own life, whether they're big or small, it doesn't really matter. They tend to start small, and then they get bigger. Like I said, it's compounding interest. It grows the more you say yes. So wherever you're at in your life, just say yes to those small or big opportunities, and realize that it's not too hard. It's probably just difficult, and you'll be amazed at the way you can find the support and resources you need. And if I can be a personal help to any veteran or anybody out there, please don't hesitate to get in touch with me.
Awesome. Well, as we close out the show, we got a few minutes left. I'm going to let you know about what's coming up in the near future. In the next few weeks, we're going to be talking a lot about what has been shut down and what are the strategies on performing at a high level when you have a new norm. It's not normal anymore to go to a theater, buy a ticket, get your popcorn, and go sit in a chair because they're not letting you do that. It's not normal to go to your Starbucks and sit and get on the internet there at the shop because the tables are turned upside down and the chairs are pushed off to the side. You can walk in, pick up, and leave. Not in a bad way. Just that's what it is. The norm has changed. In addition to that, the norm that will stick with us, in my opinion, is one that is based on virtual realities. That we're going to connect through the Zooms and the Skypes and the Google Talks, I think it was called, what Google's got out there, but they've got their version of Zoom. We're going to have more classes starting next week after spring break is over for here for schools in the Denver metro area. Kids are going to be remote testing and remote classes, four-day weeks for kids in school. But the school is coming to them electronically. We're going to have more of that. That's our norm. I'm going to share with you a producer of a new show, a new movie, a documentary movie coming out called Who We Are. And the Who We Are project is about racism in America. It was created by Jeff Robinson. Jeff is an attorney for the ACLU in Seattle, Washington, and he was born and raised in Mississippi. And thankfully for some neighborhood kids, he didn't really see color. As a young man of color, he didn't see it, but was raised in Mississippi at a time when things were not built for that. So he discovered that our history was not reflecting the reality that he grew up in, or the reality that I grew up in. And so I'm going to have Jeff on the show to talk about his documentary and how pretty much pissed off I am about the fact that my history lessons weren't exactly fully disclosed about what went on in America. And he's bringing it to our attention. So join us in the next few weeks on those shows. and we're going to have some interviews from our athletes about how do they feel about their training methods during this pandemic, because it's not the same. It's not buddy to buddy. And I'm kind of concerned about some of my guys in their bench presses. Who's going to spot for them? That's our show. Thanks for being with us. KUHSDenver.com every Friday at 11 a.m. for 360 Performance. This is Lowell Whiteman saying have a great weekend. Be safe.
Right on the money. Start at 11, end at noon.
I'm trying. I'm trying.